You are the Lord, the famous one, great is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your glorious, glorious, great is your name in on the earth. You are the Lord, the famous one, great is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your glorious, glorious, great is your fame beyond the earth. And for all you've done and yet to do, with every breath I'm praising you. Desire of nations in every heart, you alone are God, you alone are God. And you are the Lord, the famous one, the famous one, great is your name in all the earth. The heaven declares your glorious, glorious, great is your fame beyond the earth. The morning star is shining through, and every eye is watching you. Revealed by nature and miracles, you are beautiful, you are beautiful. And you are the Lord, the famous one, great is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your glorious, glorious, great is your fame beyond the earth.
I hope you're glad to be with us this morning. It is good to be in the house of the Lord together. We have a number of guests with us, so thank you for being here with us. The Turnbows, sitting there with Miss Bonnie, the Turnbows are here with us this morning. We are glad that you all are here. Most of us know them from Nebraska and then New Mexico as North American Mission Board missionaries. They have recently taken a change in position. Brother Jim will be Director of Missions in kind of the North Texas, Bowie County area, Texarkana area. And so it's good to have the Turnbows back in Texas. And I hope you all have had a good time here in these last couple of days. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. All right. I hope you had a good Christmas, and I hope you're looking forward to a new year. I want to challenge you a little bit in this morning's message to consider what things you need to put off in this old year and to put on in this new year to come. And I hope I'll challenge you a little bit to consider those things as we approach the new year. So let's take a few minutes to greet one another. Thank you.
found in the Father's love. Destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. Power in hand, speaking the Father's plan, sending us out, light in this broken land. All authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory is yours. Oh Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame.
Thank you. It's not often or every day that we have the opportunity to sing a song right out of the scripture that we're going to be hearing from in our sermon, but this next one is one of those. It's a song that if you listen to Christian radio, you're very familiar with. We've done it here several times. And it's called Jesus Messiah.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing, yeah. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the world, Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Lord of all, Lord of all.
That's my fault again. All right. I'll be glad when this year's over. It'll be a new year next year. New year next year. Won't do that again. All right. All right. Well, let me say it with the microphone. Thanks, guys, for being here. Our college students, thank you for being here. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer now. Father, this morning we thank you so much for the privilege to come together in your house. Lord, this is your church. Lord, we recognize that this body of believers who are joined together, that this is your church. It is your church here locally, not to do just your purposes here locally, but around the world. And we thank you, Father, for a mission that you give to us to go and make disciples of all nations. And God, we recognize that we are to go and make disciples. We recognize that, Lord, we are to teach one another to obey all that you have commanded us, recognizing that, Lord, you are here with us. We know that you are here this morning. We do not really need to invite you to be here. But we want to thank you, Lord, that you have chosen to be here with us. As we come together in your name, Lord, I pray that we will have our hearts ready to hear from you. I pray, Lord, before we ever even walked into the doors of the church this morning, that, Lord, we have taken some time to reflect, Lord, on your love for us, on the forgiveness of our sins that, Lord, you have offered to us, that, Lord, we would not take for granted all that you have given to us. This morning, Lord, we pray that we would worship you in spirit and in truth, that we would have confessed our sins, and Lord, if we have not confessed our sins before you, that Lord, if we have not asked you to examine our hearts and to show us, Lord, the wicked ways within us, then Lord, I pray that we will do that right now. That, Lord, we would confess to you the ways that, Lord, we have sinned against you, asking that, Lord, not only do you forgive us of our sins, but, Lord, also that you would give us the strength to overcome those sins. Lord, there are sins that dominate our lives, life-dominating sins. And God, we know that there are many who struggle with issues that, Lord, they just feel like they cannot overcome. But we know that, God, you can overcome those sins. That the power of your Holy Spirit at work in our lives, that you can overcome those sin issues. And so we call out to you, God, and we ask you to help us, to give us the kind of counsel, the kind of direction that we need in our lives. God, this morning, we are grateful for how good you have been to us. We are grateful for our salvation. We are grateful, Lord, that you do supply all of our needs according to your glorious riches. And so, God, this morning we come together as a church knowing that there are many needs among us. There are those who are struggling physically. Lord, there are sickness issues, there are pain issues, there are struggles to move about, to do the things that so many of us take for granted. And so, Lord, I pray for those who are facing physical struggles. Lord, there are emotional struggles. Lord, I know that there are those here this morning who their hearts are very heavy. They have great concerns for loved ones. They have concerns about the well-being of some of their loved ones. There are those, Lord, this morning who are facing financial struggles. Lord, there are those this morning who are facing spiritual struggles. There are Christians who are under attack by the enemy. There are those this morning who are not Christians, but Lord, You have been speaking to their hearts. You have been drawing them to Yourself. And God, they are struggling to surrender to You. The enemy is giving them every excuse in the world to not surrender to You. And so God, I pray that this morning they would surrender to You. So Father, we know that there are needs here. And God, You know those needs. And God, help us to trust Your will to be done. God, we pray for our missionaries who are serving around the world. We pray, Father, that You will use them in a great and mighty way. We pray, Father, that a great harvest would come. You have told us, Lord, that the fields are ripe unto harvest. To pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into the field. And so, God, we pray for our missionaries that have been sent out into the fields. The fields of Mali, the fields of Zambia, the fields of Indonesia, the fields of Thailand, the fields of Brazil, to the fields of Venezuela, to the fields of Mexico. So, Father, we pray for our international missionaries, not only in these countries, but, Lord, in others that we do not know their names. But, Lord, we know that there are thousands of missionaries serving in the uttermost parts of the earth. We pray, Father, for the work of our North American Mission Board missionaries all throughout North America. We do pray for the Turnbows in the change of ministries that You have given to them. We pray for the Edwards in Cheyenne, that, Lord, You will use them in a great and a mighty way. We praise You, God, for one person coming to know Christ last Sunday in their service. We thank You, Lord, that You answered prayers in that as we prayed, as others prayed, that there would be salvations. And so, God, we thank You for the work that our missionaries are doing all throughout North America. We pray, Father, for our military. We pray for those who are separated from their loved ones over Christmas. We pray for those who are coming home. We pray for those who are being deployed. We pray for their families. We pray for the protection of the men and women serving this nation. We pray, Father, for our government. We pray, Father, for some of the concerns that are looming with this fiscal cliff. We pray, Father, for our judges. We pray, Father, for our churches, that we would be Your people who will repent, Lord, of our wicked ways, who will seek Your face, because we know that the healing of this nation will come not through our government, but it will come through your church. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Our hymn this morning is 333, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Y'all stand and sing with me.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Well, good morning. I want to give you a little word from this morning's message from God's Word that I think is a wonderful, wonderful thing for us to remember. Now, have you ever been out on a playground or something and you heard somebody say something like this? Well, I'm not going to be your friend because you did this or that to me. Have you ever heard somebody say something like that? I'm not going to be your friend. I'm not going to play with you because you did something to me back then. You know what that person is doing is they're remembering something from the past and they're holding it against them. Maybe you were out there playing on the playground and somebody took a swing that you were wanting to play in and they were playing in the swing and you didn't get to play in the swing. And you said, well, I'm not going to play with you anymore because you took what I wanted. That's holding it against them. Now, there is a really wonderful verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that says, God will not hold our sins against us. You see, when we become Christians, God takes all of our sins and He forgives all of our sins and He puts them way, 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 way far away to the deepest parts of the ocean, to the farthest parts of the sky, so far away that He never remembers those to hold those against us anymore. Never again. You see, the forgiveness of our sins means that God has taken our sins and He will never hold those things against us. He will always say to us, you are my child. Your sins are forgiven. I love you. He will never bring those sins up and hold them against us. That's what it means to be a Christian and to have your sins forgiven. Would you pray with me? Father, I thank you for these children. And I thank you, Lord, that you offer to us all the forgiveness of our sins. And God, I pray that these children, as they are in their classes here at church, as they are in big church, as they are at home reading their Bibles, that God, you will help them to understand that you do love them, that you offer to us the forgiveness of our sins. And God, I pray that at the right time, each one of these children will respond to you. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
I was sure by now that you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. Once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. As the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. Every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, and though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. And I remember when I stumbled in the wind, heard my cry to you, you raised me up again. But my strength is almost gone, how can I carry on if I can't find you? And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, raise my hands, praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. I lift my eyes into the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes into the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Whoa, whoa. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear of crying, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, no, my heart is torn. I will praise you in this storm, no, my heart is torn. Praise you in this storm.
Did you hear that line? You are who you are, no matter where I am. You are who you are, no matter where I am. This year has brought some struggles. There have been storms. There have been hurts, pains, losses. And I love that line, you are who you are, no matter where I am. It's easy to praise Him when life is going well. But He is the same faithful God to us, even when we are facing the storms. I love that line. This morning we're going to focus on putting off the old and putting on the new. As we come to a new year, we come to a time of change. Like it or not, everything changes around us. Most of the time, we don't like the changes that come. I'm not sure that I experienced but about 2 months of 2012. It went so fast. There were many things that changed in 2012. For some, we wish we could go back. For others, we are glad that the change did come. But change is happening around us. And we come to a time of this new year of putting off some old ways and having the opportunity of putting on some new ways in our life. Now, it is typical that some of you are going to make a New Year's resolution. It is typical to make some sort of a resolution towards physical change, diet and exercise, namely. There are going to be some of you who are going to get on these diets. Some are crazy, radical diets that include drinking nasty stuff that cleans you and makes you not want to drink anything again. There are some of you who are going to get gym memberships. You're going to pay for a year and use a month. But you're going to make some kind of physical change. You're going to work towards some kind of physical change. This is a good time to do that. Some of you are going to make some financial changes. You're going to make some changes to your spending habits. You're going to get that credit card bill in from Christmas and say, I've got to make some financial changes here. I've got to get a second job or a third job. I've got to quit spending the way I'm spending. I've got to do a better job at some stewardship. So there may be some financial changes that you are going to face. Maybe there are some spiritual changes. Maybe as you look at your daily devotional habits, you recognize that in this past year, there has been no real change in your life in this past year from when you were sitting here a year ago. You were sitting here a year ago and there were some plans before you for how you could grow devotionally. And as you looked, you took very little to no advantage in your growth devotionally. There are things that we offer here at the church. There are many wonderful Christian bookstores that you can go and just look through any number of Bibles and find a great devotional Bible. There are many Bible reading plans. You can read through the New Testament once a month or through the year. There's a read through the Bible in a year or a three-year plan. There's a read a chapter a day. There's many different ways that you can spend time in God's Word, that you can spend time in prayer, that you can grow spiritually. And maybe some of you are going to make some choices in these next couple of days and say, I want to grow spiritually in this new year. I want to put off some of the laziness, and I want to put on some discipline. Maybe there are some lifestyle choices. Maybe there are some behavioral changes. Maybe you have been asking God, God, examine my heart, examine my life. Maybe there are some habits that you have. Maybe there is some language that you use. Maybe there is some outbursts of anger. Maybe there are things that you are watching and things that you are associating with. There are some behavioral issues that God has been dealing with your heart. And it seems like when you walk into church from time to time, God just smacks you with something. And you're at that point of saying, you know, in this new year, I want some changes to happen. And so you make some commitments. Throughout January and into part of February, we're going to focus on overcoming some old problems in the new year. So for the next couple of months, basically, we're going to focus on some old problems that we're going to overcome in this new year. Parents, I'll begin putting this into the bulletin for you, but the last Sunday in January, I'm going to ask that our younger children, and parents, this is going to be to your discretion at what age you want them to be in here, but we're going to talk about some immorality issues, overcoming some immorality issues. And our children's ministry team will have some opportunities for the children, for those of you parents who don't feel like it's time for your children to be in on a message like that. But we're going to focus on overcoming some old problems in this new year. But this morning, I want us to consider how we may need to put off some old ways of thinking and put on some new ways of thinking. Maybe we need to be thinking a little bit differently. And as I was studying, this was just one of those things that I felt like this would be a great message for us to leave out of this year with and to enter into a new year to come. So in your Bibles, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we will read verses 14 through 21 under the topic, Put Off the Old and Put On the New. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning in verse 14. For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Would you pray with me? Father, this morning as we come to this time of opening up your word and, Lord, asking you to speak to us, asking you, Lord, to open our eyes that we might see, Lord, what you would have to speak to us. Through the words of Paul from so many years ago, Lord, you spoke to that generation and, Lord, you continue to speak to our generation. Lord, this morning, I pray that you will speak to our hearts. I pray for those who do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that God, that you would speak to their hearts this morning of their need of salvation, and that God, they would respond in obedience to you. And so God, as we come together to examine your word, I pray that our hearts, our minds would be open. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Why do you live your life different? Different than those who are not Christians? Why do you live your life the way you do? Why do you live your life in such a way that you make daily sacrifices? Why do you live your life in such a way that for some of you, you have given up certain jobs. For some of you, you have given up homes. For some of you, you have given up prosperity. This might be some questions that would be asked of Paul. And Paul would say this, it is the love of Christ that controls me. And I believe that ought to be a statement for you and I. Why do you live your life the way you do? Why do you make the choices that you do? Our response should be that the love of Christ controls us. I can just imagine some people saying to Paul, "Now, Paul, why is it that you minister with such zeal? Now, Paul, why is it that you preach so boldly? Now, Paul, why is it that you would return to some of those same cities that stoned you to continue to preach to them time and time again? Paul, why do you do that?" And Paul makes this statement in verse 14. He says, "I've come to the conclusion. I have made a conclusion about life." He says, "I've made a judgment call here." It is a judicial sense of things that he says, "I've made this conclusion." He has weighed out the facts. He has considered things. He has looked at how God has been at work in his life, how God has been at work throughout all of history. He has examined the facts of Jesus Christ himself. And he says, "I've made a conclusion here." And he says, "The first thing that I've concluded is this, that one died for all. Therefore, all have died." Very simply put, Paul says, "I've come to this conclusion in my own life personally, in the life of those who were followers with me. As I think of Timothy, as I think of Titus, we've come to this conclusion. The conclusion is this, that Jesus Christ died in my place." Paul says, "I'm a sinner." He says, as I know the life of Timothy, Timothy is a sinner. As I know the life of Titus, Titus is a sinner. And Titus deserves to die. Timothy deserves to die. I deserve to die. Jesus Christ did not deserve to die, but yet Jesus Christ, who knew no sin, took sin on himself and he died in my place. Why would he do that? Why would he be that substitute? Why would he take my place when I'm the one that deserves it? 1 Peter 3:18 says, I just lost it. There you go. 1 Peter 3:18 says, "For Christ died once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring us to God." To bring us to God. Romans 5:8 says, "But God demonstrates His own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." You see, it is because of the love of Christ for you and I, the love of Christ for lost sinners, that He took that sin on Himself. He put His body in the place of ours. He made that substitution instead of us dying for our sins. He died for our sins. And Paul says that love of Christ, that love in which He would take my place on that cross, it compels me, it constrains me, it controls me, and that is why I live the life the way that I live. And so Paul says, "I have made this conclusion." If you want to know why I preach the way I preach, if you want to know why I live the way that I live, if you want to know why I sacrifice the way I sacrifice, it is because of God's love for me. It is not some legalism that says, "I must do this, 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 and this." And for you and I, we should live as Christians not because we are told that we have to act this way, but because of His love for us, that in thankfulness, in gratefulness, we live according to His Word. Paul says, "I live this way because I've made this conclusion that there is no greater love. No one will ever love me greater than what Christ has done by substituting Himself for me on that cross." But verse 15, he says this, that He died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for Christ, who for their sake died and was raised. And this is a rather simple answer. Paul says, "I've concluded that Christ has demonstrated His love in the way that He substituted Himself for me." But he says, "I've also concluded this, that He died for me that I would live for Him." He has given to us new life, folks. When we come to that point of saying, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that my sins deserve an eternity in hell. And God, I ask you to forgive me of my sins and to come into my life. That's exactly what he does. He comes into our life by giving us new life. We have been born again. We have been born new. We become a new creation. And this new creation was never intended just to continue in our old ways of life. When somebody would ask Paul, why is it that you live this way? Paul says, well, Jesus died for me. And when I came to that point of salvation, I came to that point of realizing that I no longer live for myself. As I look at what self accomplishes, as I look at what I might gain on my own, I gain nothing. There's nothing that I can accomplish. But if I live for Him, if I live for the smile of God rather than the smile of people, I do so because of the love of Christ. The love of Christ compels me. I want to ask you something. How often do you dwell on the love of Christ? I think we need to dwell on the love of Christ. Not only the love of Christ in the past, I think we need to think about the cross. I think you and I need to think about the fact that Jesus Christ left the glories of heaven and came down, that He lived that sinless life, that He was persecuted, He died on that cruel cross for you and I. That's a demonstration of His love, and you and I ought to dwell on those things. That He loved us so much that He, when He was raised to life, He offers to you and I that same newness of life. He offers to us life. I think we ought to dwell on His love in the past, but I think you and I ought to dwell on His love today. Have you sat and just given thanks for the love of Christ in your life? As you celebrated Christmas, as you spent time with family, as you spent time with friends, as you opened gifts, as you gave gifts away, have you dwelt on the greatest gift given to you? Have you dwelt on the fact that His presence is with you, whether you were in those storms or not? Will you dwell on His love? Will you stay close to Him even when life seems to fall apart? Will you dwell on His love that is to come in the future? Think about what it's going to be like when I die. That I'm going to be able to stand face to face with Jesus Christ. That I will not have sin hindering my relationship with Him. That I'll be able to praise Him. That I'll be able to talk to Him. That I will be able to hear Him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That I'll get to hear Him say, "I want to show you what I have prepared for you." That I'll get to hear Him say, "These rewards that you worked hard for, that people laughed at you for, that amounted to nothing in this life. Let me show you what you have accomplished. Because you were faithful to obey. You lived your life for me rather than living your life for yourself." You see, we need to dwell on His love because Paul says, if I'm going to be putting off some of these old things in my life, some of these habits, some of these struggles, some of these sin issues, if I'm going to put off those things, then I need to be putting on the new. I need to be thinking about His love, and my life needs to be controlled not by my abilities to overcome certain habits, but because of His love for me. You see, Paul says that we become a new creation. You and I, when we become a Christian, he says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Now, Christian, I want you to think about this for just a minute. As you look at verses 17, 18, and 19, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. As a Christian, the old has passed away. That which you had lived for in the flesh, that which you thought you were accomplishing in the flesh, but you were only guaranteeing yourself an eternity in the lake of fire, that has been put away. That old self that is going to perish in the lake of fire has been put away. We have a new life. We have a new life in this world. We have new opportunities in this world. But the greatest of all is that we have a new life to come in eternity. And so he says, we become a new creation. We're no longer of the flesh. Verse 18, he says, all of this is from God, who through Christ has reconciled us to himself. We have become a new creation because this is a gift from God. This is what Christ came to do. We were separated from God. We were enemies of God. And he has made us now to be friends of God rather than enemies of God. In verse 19, he says, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. You see, Christian, what it means, in the same way that I said to the children just a moment ago, God will not count your sins against you. Sure, you have sinned against him. Sure, I have sinned against him. But when I came to that point of believing that Jesus Christ was my Lord and my Savior, he cast those sins as far as the east is from the west. That's a picture that's given to us in the Scriptures. That he will remember those no more. That my sins that count for an eternity in the lake of fire no longer exist. They are no longer going to be held against us. You know, if you're not a Christian, I think you ought to consider those same things. If you're not a Christian, I want you to know that God desires that you would become a new creation. God desires that you would become something special to him, that he would give you that right to be a child of God. God desires to put away those old sins. You say, well, Brother Brent, you don't know the sins that I've committed. And you're right. I don't know all the sins that you've committed. But I do know this. I know a Savior, Jesus Christ, who desires to forgive you of those sins. Will you come to him today? You can't hide those sins from him. He wants you to confess them to him. Oh God, I am a sinner. Oh God, there are sins in my life. And oh God, I need you to forgive me of those sins. And verse 19 says, God, who has been reconciling the world, God who has been at work to bring you into a relationship with him, he will take those sins and he will not remember those. He will not hold those against you. He will not say, oh, I would let you into heaven, but you did this. He's going to say, I've forgiven you, my child. The blood of my son, Jesus Christ, has washed you clean. You are a new creation. And in verse 16, Paul makes this statement. He says, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, because of the love of Christ for me, but also for others. I do not view people from a carnal sense. And I'm just going to be honest with you. I'm going to be preaching to myself in these next few minutes, okay? So I apologize for talking to myself here. But I'm going to talk to myself, and if it spills off on you, go right ahead. But I view people in a carnal sense. I struggle with that. I see people in their sins, and I want to judge them. I see people in the things that they're doing, and they offend me, and I want to say something like, well, they deserve to go to hell. You You know, Paul was offended at Jesus when he was Saul. He was offended at Jesus. He was offended at Jesus' followers. Why? Because he viewed Jesus from a carnal sense. Jesus was that revolutionary. He was changing up things in life. These disciples were changing up things in life. He viewed those disciples in a carnal sense, and because of that, he hated them. He brought persecution against them. And Paul says, I've come to this conclusion that Jesus Christ, this revolutionary, this one who once offended me, that Jesus Christ, he reached down out of heaven in a unique and a special way in his life, blinding him on that road, and said, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Give your life to me. Don't be offended by me anymore. And Paul became a new creation. God reached down out of heaven to this sinner, to this one who was killing Christians. He reached out, and Paul says, I can no longer look at people in that sense anymore. I have to look at people in an eternal sense. I look at you as one who is eternal. It is not just this life that you will live. There is going to be an eternity for every single person out there. I don't care whether the way they live their life offends me or not. They are eternal. And I can only view them in two ways beyond eternal. They are either eternal and are reconciled to God. As I view people, as I should view people, as we should view people, we should view them as eternal and that they are reconciled to God. That means that their sins have been forgiven. That means that they are under construction in their Christian life. They may have failures. They may have stumblings. But you and I as Christians, we are together with them. We have been reconciled to God. Therefore, we should be reconciled together. We should be walking alongside of one another. And when one person stumbles, we reach down and we lift them out of that stumbling. When I stumble, that you would reach down and lift me out of my stumbling. That we would walk together. That we would not view somebody as, oh, that old sorry sinner. That old backslider. But we should view one another from the sense that God has reconciled me to myself. Though I may stumble, He has given me a family. I am a part of a family that we encourage one another, that we lift one another up, that we're willing to speak into the hearts of one another when we may be erring. We view people as being eternal and reconciled to God, or we view people as those who are eternal but are not reconciled to God. Think about that person who offends you the most. Think about that person who there just does not seem to be any evidence in their life that they are saved. And they offend you. They offend you by the things that they say. They offend you by the things that they do, by the way they live their life. They offend you. In verse 20, he tells us that we are ambassadors. You know what an ambassador means? It means that I stand in the place of someone else. We have ambassadors all over the world. We have ambassadors who are in Mali. And they represent our government in Mali. Will Mali be friendly towards our government? It's obvious in Libya that they were not friendly towards our government. They made a statement what they cared about our government by what they did to our ambassador. And Paul says this. Paul says, we are ambassadors for Christ. We are ambassadors for Christ, God making His appeal through us. Paul, why do you live your life the way you live your life? Because God has loved me so much, and it's because of His love that I am controlled. I am a new creation. I don't view people the way I once viewed people. I view people as those who are eternal and reconciled to God, and we are encouraging one another. Or I view myself as that ambassador. That one who sees those around me. I see my neighbor. I see my coworker. I see that relative. And I see that they have not been reconciled to God. And I recognize this one fact. God has called me as a Christian to be an ambassador to them. I am to be making that appeal on God's behalf. God is working through me that that person would come to know Christ. Jesus, who knew no sin, was made to suffer for sin so that we who do sin might know God's righteousness. You see, that person out there, that in a carnal sense they offend you. In a worldly sense, you despise them. They are either reconciled to God or not. And Paul says this, why would I go back into that city that stoned me and left me for dead? Because I see two sets of people there. I see those who have been reconciled to God, and I have a responsibility to disciple them. But I also see those who have not been reconciled to God, and when they die, they will spend an eternity in the lake of fire. We are all called to be ambassadors. Not just a couple of these missionaries in here and a couple of preachers in here. We are all called to be ambassadors. God is making His appeal through us. God should be making His appeal through you to that lost person you work with, to that lost person that you run into at a restaurant, to that lost person who's your relative. God is making His appeal through you. So here comes my challenge for you for the new year. Like I said, I'm talking to myself too, so it's my challenge for me too. But here's my challenge for you for this new year. Grow to be a stronger ambassador. Grow to be a stronger ambassador. What does that mean? It means for some of you, people don't recognize you as an ambassador. Because there are some old things in your life that you've got to put off. There are some new things that you've got to put on. And I'm not talking about the legalisms of putting this off and putting this on. But I'm saying that you grow in the love of Christ. Whether that's through your relationship with Him in your private devotional time, or whether that's through your service to Him. But you grow to be that kind of ambassador that God is making His appeal through you. I ask you to do this. I ask you to pray for people who are lost. I ask you to be willing to talk to people who are lost. And I ask you to do something that's rather novel. It's rather unique. You're going to be shocked that I'm going to ask you to do this. But invite them to church. Shocking, huh? Invite them to church. Do you know that you have a neighbor? Do you know that you have a coworker? Do you know that you have another student at the school who sits in the desk across from you, or sits over in that corner who doesn't really associate with others? And they would respond to your invitation? Because they have been seeing Christ lived out in your life, and they're hungering for the same. They're thirsting for the same. But we do have to be honest. It just may be that there are some things we need to put off and leave in 2012. That by the time we come to December of 2013, you will be a stronger ambassador for Christ. That what people are seeing is Christ in you rather than you living for yourself. Paul says, I've concluded this. I've concluded that the salvation of my soul is not for me, but it is for God to do His work in your life, in your life. I will not live for myself, but I will live for God, who will make His appeal through me to others. Would you pray with me? Father, we recognize that the reality is we have nothing to offer to You. We come to You as sinners. We come to You just as we are. But we recognize that, God, You want to make us a new creation. You don't want us to stay as we are, as pleasers of self, as pleasers of others. But God, You want us to be people who are living for You. And God, I know that there are some in here this morning. There's a real good possibility that there are those this morning who do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. They've never come to that point of saying, oh God, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that You can forgive me of my sins. I know that You are willing to forgive me of my sins. And so God, today I surrender my life to You. I want to be Your ambassador. I want to walk with You. I want to live my life for You. Not because there's a rule book that I must follow, but because I know that Jesus Christ loved me so much that He died in my place. And He rose to life on that third day, offering to me eternal life that I could not gain in any way except through Him. And so, God, I pray this morning for anyone who does not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that this morning that they would come take me by the hand and say, Preacher, I want to know Christ as my Lord and Savior. I want my life to be pleasing to Him. God, this morning, I also pray for those who are Christians. And God, as they examine their hearts, maybe they are recognizing that there are some old ways that You have cleansed us from. You've made us a new creation, that those old things would not still be a part of our lives. But we're not living for You, Lord. We're living for ourselves. And God, maybe there are some who need to come this morning and even bow at the altar and say, oh God, I want to leave these old ways behind. I know that You have new life for me. I know that there are new ways for me. And God, I want to live for You. God, I want to see people through Your eyes. I want to see people as people who have been reconciled to You, God. And though they may stumble, though they may struggle in their walk, God, I want to come alongside them and help them to grow in their walk. God, I want to view people who are lost as people who have not been reconciled to You. You sent Your Son Jesus to die for them. And God, they need to hear. God, they need to see in my life. God, You are wanting to make an appeal through me. You want me to be an ambassador. And so, God, I'll make a commitment. I'll pray for lost people. I will look for lost people. I will talk to lost people. God, I will invite lost people not only to church, but I'll invite them to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So, God, this morning in this time of invitation, we're going to sing Just As I Am. And God, I thank You that I came to You just as I am. But God, You made me a new creation who is worthy, not because of my works, but because of the love of Jesus Christ. You have made me worthy of the kingdom of God. Worthy to be called Your child. So God, as we sing, God, I pray that anyone who needs to respond would do so in obedience. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. I want to ask you to stand. We're going to sing "Just As I Am." Do you need to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? This morning, are you a Christian? And God is speaking to your heart about the kind of love that you need to have for someone who's lost. Maybe this morning, you've had very little love for those who are lost. Would people say a year from now, you know what? I know why you do the things that you do in this life. I know why you share Christ with others. Because I can see that the love of Christ is controlling you. How do you need to respond this morning? Let's sing "Just As I Am."
Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God.
You can be seated if our ushers will come forward to collect our offering. Let me share just a couple of announcements to you. There'll be no evening activities, our regular scheduled time tonight. But tomorrow night, we will meet up here for a New Year's Eve celebration time. There'll be a couple of different things going on. One, bring food. That's just a pretty good given, right, for Baptists. Bring food. Just bring various kinds of finger food, snacks, things that you'll enjoy eating on. Bring some games. We're going to play games, have some fellowship time together. Our children's ministry team is going to have a special kids' zone time from 8:30 to 9:30. They're going to take them to another part of the building and do some special games and activities with them, and then they'll come back in and join the rest of us. Our youth are actually traveling down to Austin to do Mania Marathon. Can they still sign up for that? Today is the last day. Mania Marathon is an all-night. It's not really a lock-in because you're locked in to about three or four different places. They're going to have a time that they'll be doing laser tag, a time they'll be doing bowling, a time of watching movies, and inflatables, okay? And then for some reason they're going to have a whole bunch of eating too. I don't know why we always do that. But a great time of worship as well. And so today is the last day to get signed up for that. Talk to Russell about that if you're able to go. They're going to leave at 6:30 tomorrow, 6:30 p.m., drive down to Austin, and then we'll pick them back up. We're going to pick y'all back up at 7 in the morning, so they should be back here somewhere around 8 at 8:30, okay? So they will not be driving themselves back because they will be awake all night long. So it'll be a good time. Come join them. Youth, if you have the opportunity. Let me mention one thing to you in reference to devotionals. I've been back and forth whether I would continue doing devotionals. I generally do these once a year and take a break because they take a good bit of time. I this week made a decision that I am going to do devotionals again this year. I'm going to do them a little bit differently. We're going to go through the Proverbs this year. Will not be as much reading. And so maybe this will be something that will appeal to some people who are not great fans of reading. But we're going to go through Proverbs. And basically each week we will focus on one topic in the Proverbs. Proverbs is just scattered topics all through there. And so we're going to take a topic per week and look at various Proverbs. And whether it's anger issues or positive things such as God's blessings and joy in our lives from His wisdom and His discernment. Each week we'll have different things that we focus on through the Proverbs. Encourage you to learn from the things that God has for us in that. Glenn, would you close us with a word of prayer?